The train has left the station. It is inevitable that artificial intelligence will consume our lives. Like, people don't realize that they are interacting with AI agents every day, multiple times a day. If you are online, if you're using any type of map, if you are calling someone on the phone, you're using a ton of algorithms. There is so much opportunity to enhance our quality of life, but with that opportunity, it comes responsibility as well. My whole thing is, how do you take control? How are you provided the power to ensure that this doesn't have a negative impact?
Just what are digital computers? Are they superhuman machines that can solve any kind of problem?
Our technology is impacting the world in positive ways, but also negative ways. And therefore, it is our responsibility to ensure that we are mitigating the negative, because we can do it on the algorithm side if we just take a moment to think about it. My name is Ayanna Howard, Dr. H, and I am a roboticist. It is an exciting time to be a roboticist, to be designing and developing AI algorithms, because AI sort of rules the world.
Hello, human.
One of the things that AI is used for is more social interactions, everything from social media to even dating apps. And so you think, oh, there's no harm in that. But the fact is, people are fairly easy to model, which means that AI can influence our behaviors. These AI systems are cast as authority figures. These AI systems are cast as the experts because they have more data than I possibly could know about as an individual human. And so we trust that these systems know more than us. And therefore, we are more likely to take whatever the AI system says and take it as truth. And that's kind of a problem because these AI agents make mistakes. So after NASA, I came to Georgia Tech and started up my own lab. My group works in this area of deception and trust. So if an AI system tells a human something, if an AI system suggests something, an individual is more likely to take that guidance as truth. That's a form of trust. What we wanted to look at is if a robot made mistakes and did something that might harm you, would you trust the robot in terms of its decision making? And so we brought people into a building and we simulated emergency evacuation, smoke and fire alarms. And you know, the robot, it just would spin in place and things like that. And people time and time again would follow the guidance of the robot. In certain cases, alarms are going, smoke is going, and the robot's just sitting there like, I don't know what I'm doing. And people would just stand there and be like, well, robot must know what it's doing because, you know, it's smart, right? And again, it blew away our hypothesis because we did not expect that. My lab and my students, we also work on creating solutions for some of these systems that aren't done right. Because we can very easily lose our ability to have autonomy once we start believing and trusting all the algorithms that come out. So ethics is really important when it comes to AI, because these systems are going to be used by everybody. I want to make sure that people and the general public understands that AI is here. Right? It's in everything that we do, but also that we have a power to decide how we're going to use these systems and understand that we have a choice. I want people to understand what AI is.
Yet as complicated as they might appear, digital computers are basically simple.
So an algorithm, and we throw out, you know, algorithm, artificial intelligence. So basically an algorithm is a piece of software that takes data inputs and makes a decision based on that input. This is not new, right? So the algorithms, people think, oh, deep neural networks, like this is, no, honey. A lot of these algorithms have existed at least since the 60s and the 70s.
We are experimenting with a mobile robot associated with intelligence.
To create these intelligent agents, it has to have data. And the data is based on people. So one of the things about using these data sets is that they maintain some of the historic biases. Explicit bias is discrimination, right? That's racism. Implicit bias is just the way that we grew up, the perceptions that we have is implicit because we don't necessarily know how we got them. You know, implicit bias we think of as more of a human attribute or characteristic, and you know, we talk about the data. But the AI system then inherits that bias, which then unfairly disadvantages certain groups. So robots aren't inherently racist or sexist, but they can learn to be. One of the problems about AI, the power is that it's learning from humans. The negative is that it's learning from humans. And, you know, historically, people have changed their perception. Historically, people have been biased and realized, oh, yeah, women, maybe they should vote, right? And things have changed and shifted. And that means that when the systems are learning from human data, they may also be learning some of that historical bias that is present, that we recognize now, but the AI system doesn't.
The car is designed from the inside out.
Engineering traditionally has not really thought about social impact. And a lot of times we were like, well, why? It's engineering. How does someone who's, you know, female, why does that make a difference? But the fact is that when we design solutions, if we don't have someone with a different experience, we're going to design the wrong solution. As an example, airbags, because the teams were mostly men, didn't realize that the average human is not 5'9 and 180 pounds. Like, that's not the average human. And then we found out that more women die in car crashes because of the airbags. A decision was made where no one just asked because no one was in there to say, hey, like, you know, humans include females as well. My dad was an engineer. My mom was a mathematician. I thought it was typical, African-American family. So as a high school student, my label was a smart kid, right? Like, I was in the gifted classes. You know, it was brainiac. But in college, I very quickly realized that my label was black. In my engineering classes, I felt so isolated. Most of my classmates came from private schools. Most of my classmates came from environments that weren't like mine. And when you look around and no one looks like you, where your instructors don't look like you, you think, well, maybe engineering is not what I should be doing because obviously there's not a place for me here. If you have someone who wanted to be an engineer, wanted to be a roboticist, since they were basically in the sixth grade, and in 1 year you have them doubting themselves, there's something fundamentally wrong with the system. Engineering is about problems that have not been solved. And they haven't been solved for a reason. They haven't been solved because people are looking at it the exact same way. So I started realizing the value of my perspective when I became basically a project manager at NASA. Because again, I was going into the room and you know I was talking to engineers and I was like, hey, have you thought about it this way? And it was so interesting because it was like, oh, no, we hadn't. And it wasn't like, you know, I read a different book or I studied in a different way. It's just that the lens that I looked at things was just different. In order to solve the hard problems in society and the world, you have to think outside the box.
Hello, human. Ooh, it's nice in here.
My name is Canton Rogers. I'm currently a third-year computer science PhD student. So in this lab, we investigate and try to understand how do humans interact with AI, artificial intelligence systems, and robotics. Most people in the lab, and Ayanna herself, likes to look at trust, how people come to trust robots, how people come to trust technology. But for me, I was like, you know, if I'm gonna work on something for like 6 years, I have to be interested, and I like the drama. I like the spice. Why not think about deception, which is this offset of trust, but why don't we spin it in this notion here about thinking about how these systems are lying to humans and what's the extent that we can push that? To be preventative, of course, I'm not trying to aid in that robot apocalypse. My research is focused on, it's like a spicy question. Animals lie, humans lie, and so should robots and technology lie? So I'm asking the question of if, when, and should AI and robots lie to humans?
Hmm.
I feel like a lot of people think it's taboo. And surprisingly, Ayanna was on board. I have told Ayanna, I was like, man, I don't know if you're a human sometimes. I swear she doesn't sleep. Ayanna has goals. I've said that for a while. When I grow up, I want to be like Ayanna. Just having her presence and being such a thought leader and kind of defying the odds and like breaking the mold of who is seen to be successful in these spaces is so very empowering for people like me who are on the come up trying to make a name for themselves. Ayanna is always thinking about the future and how the things that she's working on and her students are working on are affecting the world. She was not only on board, but very supportive and constantly asking me questions like why? Like, why is it that you think that this is something that we should care about? Whose lives is this actually impacting? When we are creating chatbots and things that people are interacting with, those are programmed in such a way to make people believe that it's a human.
I'll try my best to help you.
To believe that there's certain genders that this robot or something has, and it has none of that. It's just a bunch of wires and circuitry. But they do this on purpose to manipulate how people interact with these systems. And it is a type of deception. And I think it's important for us to name it as such, because then as we start pushing that boundary more and more, we can then start thinking about regulation and what should or shouldn't happen. I've been very fortunate to be mentored by people in my life that have forced me to think about these questions. But also life in general, being a Black man in the US, you know, you have to think about who's getting hurt by systems. And so being kind of cultivated in that space, I think does give my perspective added value.
Diversity is important for engineering. Diversity of thought, diversity of experiences. My PhD students represent the world. They are diverse in terms of gender, in terms of domestic US versus international, and represent minorities. About half of them are from those groups versus not. We learn through interaction. We learn through questioning. We learn through each other. And so traditionally, when I'm in a classroom, I'm there. I will ask hard questions. I will ask sometimes provocative questions. You know, just because you can create a perfect gadget, that's fun, shouldn't you? And they are going to think differently. If we think about our roles and responsibilities as engineers, and we think about the role that diversity has in coming up with solutions, it means energy and water and food scarcity and education can be solved by engineers, right? Like, that's the power of engineering. If we as engineers don't claim this, if we as engineers don't think about our responsibility when we're creating new technology, rules and regulations are going to come down on us. And the problem is that when these regulations come, they will sort of extinguish creativity. And that's not in anyone's best interest. And so thinking about what we need to do, thinking about the checks and balances we can instill so that the public understands that, you know, we got this. We can do this better. Let's look at the systems where we know that there's negative impact and lean into fixing those. And so we know that AI is being used in surveillance. there's some issues. Well, if it's being used, let's go and lean and fix that. We know AI is being used in healthcare for the good, but there's still some negatives. Let's go in and fix that. And I think right now, making sure we fix what's already being used is our first priority. And then as we've accomplished that, one, we'll learn how it's done, which means as we're designing new applications, we can then fix them before these systems are even out there and deployed. AI is inevitable. It is part of our future. It will and has started to become part of our DNA, part of who we are as a society, part of who we are as a culture and a nation. And that's the power of AI, but we have to make sure that we do it right in order to receive all the benefits and mitigate any of the negatives. I will be the dean of the College of Engineering at The Ohio State University. So to be the dean of a College of Engineering is a major deal. Like all the things I've talked about, like responsible engineering, like as dean, I can influence the curriculum so that that happens and then it becomes the gold standard for the rest of the institutions to do this right. It's a big deal because I get to mold what the face of engineering looks like. I get to actually have an impact on ensuring that engineering looks like the world around, looks like the solutions that we're creating for the world. I didn't have that when I was young. And to be able to do that for someone makes it so that I know that this is my role. I know that this is one of my responsibilities to ensure that people see me.